Good morning, OCV. Merry Christmas. It is the third day of Christmas, and if you thought those days came before Christmas, nope. The 12 days of Christmas come after, starting on Christmas Day. And here we are on the third day of Christmas, which is Christmastide. And so it's a time for celebration. Sometimes in the Western Church, we think Christmas is past after all the presents are unopened, but really, Christmastide has historically been this time of celebration. So we're going to keep it going with Angels We Have Heard on High.
Christ is
Well, good morning, church. Merry Christmas. As I said earlier, we are on the third day of Christmas. I think it's actually an amazing thing in the church calendar that Advent is this long lead up, and then Christmas comes, and it doesn't just end, you know? You're not like that little kid, I don't know if you were ever like this, I was definitely like this, where, you know, the day after Christmas, and you're like, oh, or the night of Christmas, you're like, man, I'm so bummed, I have to wait another year. You know, everything in our culture is a build-up till that day, and then you get all the stuff. But in the church calendar, it was a build-up till the day, and then the celebration continued 12 days until you kind of capped it off with Epiphany on January 6th, the day that the church celebrated the Magi's coming to see the baby. So, I don't know, I think we have a little backwards, And honestly, the cynical history, I'll just give a little historical aside for those of you like this. And if you've been around OCB, you've heard me say this. The little historical aside is, you know, that kind of tradition of 12 days of Christmas really kind of started to end in the Industrial Revolution when business owners started to realize we could lose fewer days of work but still sell the same amount of stuff if we just jammed it all into one day. And so there's kind of this consumeristic background to it. So, you know, and with little to celebrate after Christmas anymore, Advent became the season that instead of thinking about this longing for Jesus, we actually just, like, kind of celebrate early because Christmas comes and goes as one day of the year. So, okay, I'm off my soapbox. Actually, I'm still on it, but you get what I'm saying. I'm going to stop my little rant there, but all that to say, we are in the middle of Christmastide. It's not over. It's not another memory. Merry Christmas. Christ is born. He is born in Bethlehem. We say that just like at Easter when we celebrate this another season where the church has this long kind of season of celebration. We say Christ is risen, right? And we're going to do that today with Christmas. We're going to say Christ is born. And you say it with me at home. He is born in Bethlehem. Christ is born. He is born in Bethlehem. Christ is born. He is born in Bethlehem. Amen. That's the truth. So this morning, I'm going to just offer what I hope is going to be a brief reflection of what C.S. Lewis called the grand miracle. That's God coming down and taking on flesh, God becoming one of us and then giving his life to die. The gospel is the grand miracle, as C.S. Lewis called it. And really, we'll see that this act of God humbling himself to become one of us and then taking the form of a servant, even dying the death the most gruesome death he could at the end of his life on a cross. All of this is a grand miracle, and it all starts with the incarnation on that Christmas morning 2,000 plus years ago. The incarnation changes everything. It shows us what love looks like, literally, right? It's God, the Bible tells us in 1 John, John the Apostle tells us that God is love. We'll read about that later.
But that's an abstract thing until we see what God looks like when he actually takes and puts meat on, carne, right? Puts meat on the incarnation. Becomes one of us. We can see, oh, that's what love looks like. It looks like Jesus Christ giving his life for the world, living for others and not for himself, the servant of all. That's what love looks like. Now, if you remember in this Advent Christmas series, we've been studying kind of the anchor text for us has been Paul's letter to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 13, where he says, these three abide, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love. Now, one of the things we talked about is how the role of faith and hope are things we need for right now. Faith on what God's done and gives us courage to believe him for today. And hope keeps us from giving in to despair. It's a future-oriented hope. We know what God will do. It's a trust that he has a good future plan for his people. Those things are so important to living right now, preparing our character, forming us, as we talked about many times, forming us for and preparing us for God's kingdom. But the thing is, in the kingdom, we don't need as much faith and hope, really, right? Because like Paul told the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians 5, you know, when we see, we won't need faith. When we see God face to face. Or like Romans 8 says, for in this hope we were saved. This was a hope that God was going to redeem the creation, redeem us and restore us, that Jesus was the first fruits. This hope we were saved. Now, hope that's seen is not hope, Paul says. For who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. You see, faith and hope are virtues that form our character now. But one day we won't need them. We'll see God face to face. We won't need a hope for the future because we'll be in his promised future. But you know what will stay consistent? That will never fail, that will never fade, is love. You see, love is in the essence of God's character. He says he is love. John tells us that in 1 John. That God, the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, exists in relationship with himself. And in that relationship, there is love. And that's part of God's very essence. You've heard me preach on this before. That will not change in the new heaven and the new earth. That will not change in the kingdom of God. Love will continue. In fact, it will only grow deeper and we'll understand it more fully. The love of God for us and the love that we can have for God and for each other. That's a great promise. And that's why this Christmas day, this third day of Christmas, this Christmas Sunday of 2020, I want to focus on love. Because Christmas is one of the epic acts of love in the entire creation. Think about it. Love is what motivated God to come down. His love for his creation, his love for part of his creation that has flesh and bones, us, human beings. That's what John tells us. Go ahead and turn to the Gospel of John, the first chapter. It's a very famous passage. I want to read a little bit of it today. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. And all things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life. In the Word, in Jesus Christ, was life, John tells us. And the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Skipping ahead to verse 9. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him. His very hands crafted the universe, the Bible tells us. He holds the seas in his palm. And yet, even though he made the world, John tells us in verse 10, the world did not know him. He, Jesus, came to his own, and his own people, the Jewish people, didn't receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he, Jesus, gave the right to become children of God. That's you, that's me. If we believed in his name, there's one name under heaven by which we can be saved, and that name is Jesus Christ. If we believe in his name, he's given us the right through grace to become children of God. John goes on to say, these children of God, we were not born, not of blood, nor by the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but God. God reached out to you. If you know him, he took the first move. He came after you. And by the way, he's after everyone. You don't know a single person that God's not working on. A single person the Holy Spirit doesn't want to pull their heart to God. And then this verse. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we've seen his glory. Glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness about him and cried, "This one is he whom he said, 'He comes after me, he ranks before me because he was before me.' For from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, the only God, who's at the Father's side, has made him known." And that last verse, that speaks of the incarnation. No one's ever seen God, but the only God. Let's talk about the second part of the Trinity. The only God who's at his side, that's Jesus Christ, has made him known. Do you know how we know what God looks like in his character? Do you know how we know who God really is? It's through Jesus Christ. Jesus spoke 100% truly about his Father. And we know what God is like through Jesus. Now, there's a few things we've seen in this passage, right? We see the coming of a light into a dark world. That's what Jesus did. It's so fitting that we celebrate Christmas just a few days after winter solstice. When things are at their darkest, Jesus brings the light. What else do we see? A commitment to dwell among us. In the Greek, it talks about tabernacling among us. He put his tent down. He drove in the pegs right with us. If we're here in this desert like the Israelites, they knew what it was like to be nomadic wanderers, right, in their history. And then God says, "I'm going to dwell right with you. I'm going to tabernacle right with you." But this time it's not in the Holy of Holies we can't reach, but it's in a human being that we can reach out and touch. We also see that God allowed himself to feel pain and rejection, right? He came to his own people, and his own people didn't know him, didn't receive him. I mean, think about that. He makes humanity, and he makes this one nation he sets aside for himself. He loves them. When they reject him time after time, he keeps coming back like a wounded lover. And he says, "Okay, I'll forgive you. Come back to me." Time after time, they reject him. Then he says, "Okay, I'll do you one better. I'm going to send myself." God himself, through his Son, Jesus Christ, comes to us. His people say no. And if we're honest, it's not just his people back then, it's us. So many times God said, "Love me, follow me." We said, "No, not today." He said, "Not thy will be done today, my will be done today." He didn't have to feel pain. He didn't have to feel rejection. He lets himself. We see a desire, though, to reveal his love and his goodness to humanity in a way that we can understand. He speaks our language. He comes in our humanity, fully God, but still fully man. It's a mystery, but it's a great one, a wondrous one. You see, John, the beloved apostle, loves to tell us about God's love. He does it time after time. In fact, he has some of the most famous verses in the entire Bible about the love of God. Right? If you've watched a football game, if you've watched pretty much anything, you've seen John 3:16 somewhere, right? And what's it say? "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life." And then into verse 17, he says, "God didn't send his Son into the world to condemn it, but in order that the world might be saved through him." This is God's love story, and it looks like this baby. John tells us about him in his gospel time after time. And even though he says he came to his own didn't receive him, he still kept coming. Even though he was a light in the darkness couldn't overcome it. Jesus Christ is love with flesh and blood. Now, 1 John is another book that John wrote. And we see in that book even more fully the love of God. And that's kind of where I want to spend the little bit of our last time together. Like I said, this is going to be a shorter reflection today. And I just want to spend a little bit of time in the epistle that John, the apostle, writes to the church in 1 John. And, you know, if we call 1 Corinthians 13 the love chapter, honestly, 1 John is like the love book. This book is all about what does it look like to love God and what will that look like in our lives. And honestly, it's one of those books of the Bible. If you're a new believer or you're kind of like not at home in Scripture, you know, maybe you grew up in a tradition that didn't encourage you to read Scripture. This book of 1 John is a very short one, right at the tail end of the Bible, written by the beloved Apostle John. This book is one of those books in the Bible that you really almost don't even need a preacher to preach it. It is so straightforward, so reassuring and yet cutting at the same time. It cuts out any excuse we make for sin or bearing grudges, and yet it reassures us time and time again of God's love. I highly recommend that you just take some time this Christmas season and in the weeks to come, maybe in the new year you want to think about orienting your life around love, to spend some time in John's gospel. Because this is where John takes time to really dig into the love of God, but it's very accessible. We're going to dig into a few this week. Just a few passages out of here and kind of wrap up. Listen to how he starts. We just read the Gospel of John, chapter 1, in some of the early verses. This is the epistle of 1 John, and let's start in chapter 1, verse 1. That which was from the beginning, which we've heard, which we've seen with our eyes, which we've looked upon and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. The life was made manifest, and we have seen it. And we testify to it and proclaim to you eternal life, which is from the Father, which was made manifest to us. Remember, Jesus was coming to reveal the Father. It was made manifest to them, that which we have seen and heard and proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us. Indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. And we are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. We're going to sing joy to the world. If there's any cause for joy, it's the fact that love has come and that love will save the day. Love will win in the end. Love does win. And Jesus is going to come back. The first advent always points to the second. And John's saying, we want you to know this joy and think about how he describes it. How many times in that short passage has he said, that which we've seen with our eyes, which we've touched with our hands, which we've looked upon, that was made manifest to us, right? Which we've seen, that's what we're proclaiming. That is only possible because of Christmas, because of Christ's coming, the incarnation. It's a doctrine in the church that we need to just hold on to so tightly. We can't lose the wonder of the incarnation. Even everything around the cross and Good Friday and Easter, it as good as it is, it all really hinges on the incarnation. If Jesus didn't put flesh on, if God didn't become human, one of us, and he didn't take his son to his right hand side with that flesh still on. I mean, I've said it before, but it bears saying every week, when God looks to his side, he sees a human being, his beloved and only son, Jesus Christ. And when he sees that human being, guess who he cannot forget about? You, me, us. That is Christmas love. That God, who makes these creatures out of dust, loves them enough to say, I'll take on that dust-like frame. And I'll show you what I made you for. You don't have to live in sin. You don't have to live in death. Let me show you what I made you for. And he lives a perfect life. And death can't touch him unless he lets himself die for our sake. Which, if you know the story of Jesus, is exactly what happens. That is love. That's Christmas. And that's what we hold on to. That's why it bears celebrating more than one day, more than through a few presents and through a few credit card bills. It bears celebrating in a whole season of Christmastide and through the rest of the year. The incarnation is our foundational doctrine, Jesus is God, fully God, fully human. And that changes everything. Everything changes. The grand miracle. And John says, this is how you know what I'm saying is true. I've seen it. I've touched him. God, I want to reveal him and proclaim him. And he says, I want you to have this joy and I want you to have fellowship. And that's what the book of 1 John goes in to talk about. How to have fellowship with this God who loves us and with each other. And isn't that what life is about? What Christmas is about? Fellowship with the God who loves us and then with the people whom God also loves. Let's look at a couple passages. 1 John chapter 2. Verses 15 to 17. John starts kind of by telling us what not to love, right? Don't love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the love of the Father is not in him. For all that's in the world, the desires of the flesh, the desires of the eyes, the pride of life, it's not from the Father, but it's from the world. And the world's passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever. John says, if we're going to orient our love right, we're going to live into this reality that God himself has come in the greatest act of love ever, that Christmas morning. And then the rest of his life just added to that theme and chorus. If we're going to live like that, the first thing is to know what not to love. And it's the world, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, the lust of the eyes. All the things the world says, money, sex, power, all the things the world says, this will fulfill you. John says, no way. You love that, it's going to pass away, right? You ever watch someone get really old and try to hold on to all their power and their money and everything that came with it? Right? Hugh Hefner in Playboy Mansion trying to hold on to all the lust of the eyes. And he's a wrinkly old man in pajamas. That's what happened. Read about it. That's what happened. Right? That's what the love of the world will do to us. The Christmas packages eventually get old. The wrapping paper eventually gets crumbled up and thrown away or burned. But the love that defines Christmas lasts forever, right? Faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love, Paul says. So what do we do with that? What's it look like? Well, love always looks like something. In fact, I would say it looks like someone, right? Skipping ahead to John 3. See what kind of love the Father has given to us? That we should be called children of God, and so we are. The reason the world doesn't know us is that it didn't know him, right? We just read about that. He came to his own didn't receive him, John told us earlier. Beloved, we're God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him. When Christ comes back, he's going to resurrect the dead, and he's going to raise us up to newness of life in him, bodies that are incorruptible. That's the Christian doctrine. Jesus is our first fruits. 1 John 4, verse 14. We've seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. See, John keeps coming back to this. This is the big idea. God, the Father, has sent his Son. He's the Savior. He's the light. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God abides in him, and he in him. So we have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is showing us in any way he can. He loves us. Every single person listening to this, God is pursuing you in love, not in wrath, not in anger. He's not out to get you. He wants you to know that you are valuable, that he loves you. He's created you for a purpose. The world wants to give you all this fleeting stuff that, like Christmas morning, can't last and leaves you with kind of an empty feeling when it's all over. But God wants to give you the love that's new every morning and that doesn't end even when our life here on this planet does. We've come to know and believe it. God is love, John says in verse 16. And whoever abides in love abides in God. And God abides in him. But this love is perfected with us, so that we may have confidence for the day of judgment. Because as he is, so are we in the world. There's no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. That's how we know love, through Jesus. And what's this love do? It does two things. The first thing it does is it makes us want to live for God. Look at John 3 again, verses 3 through 8. Everyone who thus hopes in God purifies himself as he is pure. Everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he appeared in order to take away sins. In him there's no sin. That's Jesus. No one who abides in him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen him or knows him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Whoever practices righteousness is righteous, as he, Jesus, is righteous. Whoever makes a practice of sinning is of the devil. No one born of God makes a practice of sinning. So the first way that we live into this love is to actually live holy lives. Now, John knows that we're not going to be perfect. He tells us in 1 John 1:9, just a few verses ahead, that if we confess with our mouths, or if anyone, I'm just going to read it. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You've heard me say this time after time. He knows that God's children sometimes sin, but he says here, if we make a practice of it, we're basically throwing aside our birthright. So Christmas morning, this love that we see show up on Christmas, the first thing it should pull us toward is a life lived for God. A life not lived for the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, the things the world wants to capture our hearts with, but a life captured, a heart captured by this great God who gave himself to us on Christmas morning and then lived this amazing life and then died for us and rose again to conquer death, and he will come back. That love compels us to live holy lives, set apart lives, lives that are pure. One way we know we love God is that we actually do what he says. We'll see that later in 1 John 4 and 5. Listen to this. This is 1 John 4:19 into chapter 5, and then we're going to be done really soon. We love because he first loved us. If anyone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he's a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. And this commandment we have from him, whoever loves God must also love his brother. Did you catch that? That's the second part of what love does to us. It not only orients our heart to the desires of God, to living a holy life, but it orients our heart to loving others. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he's not seen. We aren't like John. We didn't see and touch Jesus. We believe it on faith right now. Someday faith will be sight. Someday we'll see him face to face. And that will be a great day. But right now we have it. But we do see another human being that actually looks a lot like Jesus did. More like him than not, right? Another human around us. On the street, in our cubicle at work, in our family, around the table. Are we loving them? Even in our church, are we loving the representative of God that we see in front of us? And this is how John starts the last chapter in his letter. Everyone who believes that Jesus Christ has been born of God, and everyone who loves the Father, loves whoever has been born of him. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and obey his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that overcomes the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? Do you know how we overcome the world? Isn't that what we talked about most of the fall? Not being overcome by evil, but overcoming evil by good. You see, we're still talking about spiritual formation. Christmas and all the things we go through, in some ways, spiritual formation, if done right. We're talking about how to form our hearts to love the things God loves. And that means our brothers and sisters. That means the human beings that we encounter every day that God made in his image. And that means our Father in heaven and our Savior, Jesus Christ. And we love them through obeying God's commands. And as we obey them in love, we'll find they're not burdensome. It's not a list of rules. It's actually a relationship. It's like a parent who asks their child to do something. The parent has the best will, best interest of the child at heart. And the child responds out of love and does it. That's the relationship, what it's supposed to be like. Sometimes in our families, that's not the case. Believe me, I know. Sometimes you ask a child to do something and they don't. And when we get frustrated, God must be thinking, yep, I know. I know just what that feels like. But this Christmas season, lean into love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. And how he gave him was as a baby in a manger. It's the most amazing story ever. It's a wondrous story. Get lost in the wonder of it all. It's the grand miracle of God, who is beyond anything we could taste, touch, see, sense. We can't even imagine what God the Father looks like. He said, I'm going to make myself available. And instead of presents at Christmas, we get his presence. That's the best present of all. Let's be loving people. It's love that overcomes the world. If we want to overcome evil with good, it's love. Love that we see in that manger and that we take on as a family trait, as the children of God. Love for God that results in our obedience and our holiness. And love for neighbor results in love that's powerful and that can overcome evil. These things, faith, hope, and love, endure. But the greatest of these is love. That's the story of Christmas. Father, let us be people who love. Show us your way. Help us walk in it. Form our hearts and our desires this Christmas season and into this new year. We are ready and hungry for a new year. But we don't want to live it without you. We don't want to go forward in our own strength. Help us, Father. At this point, we're going to go into a time of communion. And this week, I wrote down a few things. A confession I'd like to read, and I know you can't read it at home the same way we would in church, but maybe you can listen. So this Christmastide morning, this third day of Christmas, amid all the joy of Christmas, we remember that God's love led the way to every good thing. And we remember this love looks like something, and it looked like Jesus giving his life for us. And that's what this meal pulls us back to, time after time. We remember that Christ's willingness to take on flesh was the first step toward his betrayal, his suffering, his death. We remember that on the night he was betrayed, he took the bread. And giving thanks, he blessed it and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body, broken for you. And likewise, after supper, he took the cup, saying, drink of this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. On this Christmastide morning, let's confess together. And here's the confession. Just listen to it. And then we'll take a second to let it sink in. God our Father, you sent your Son full of grace and truth. Forgive us our failure to receive him. Lord, have mercy. Jesus our Savior, you were born in poverty and laid in a manger. Forgive our greed and our rejection of your ways and your love. Christ, have mercy. Holy Spirit, your servant Mary responded joyfully to your call. Forgive the hardness of our hearts. Lord, have mercy. Take a minute to give him your personal confession. Confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's the word of the Apostle John to us this morning. He will forgive, and Christ will cleanse you. Let's eat and drink in that good hope. The body of Christ broken for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. Christ is born. He is born in Bethlehem. Christ is born. He is born in Bethlehem. Christ is born. He is born in Bethlehem. Amen. That's the truth. And may the God who took on flesh because of his love, may the God who still looks like us because of love, may Jesus Christ, the light of the world, bless you this Christmas season and in the year to come. May he keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. And may he give you peace. Go be God's people, his Advent people, who know the first coming and look for the second in his creation, and live like joy. We're going to sing about that now. Joy to the world. And then let's go tell that joy from every mountaintop we possibly can. Merry Christmas, church.
Amen. God's love gives us a reason for joy. So let's sing a classic song, Joy of the World. It's a song Amy and I love to play together. We played it many times. We'll see if we can play it right. It's not guaranteed. We're a little rusty, but let's just sing with joyful hearts.
Tell it on the mountain.
Tell it on the mountain, church. Spread the good news. Merry Christmas.